Department at the University of the Philippines in Diliman. And then Dr. Soriano is chair of the Communication Department at De La Salle University and has authored papers and books on digital media and social and political transformations. So we will again, if you have questions that occur to you, ask the panelists who are speaking, please write them down on a piece of paper and then hand them over to our lovely ushers over here and in the shirts in green, and they will, those in green shirts, and they will hand it over here and we'll ask the questions for you. If the question is for a specific person in the panel, please write it down as well. So we'll start by hearing some initial thoughts from each of our panelists, around 5 to 10 minutes each. After that, we'll have some questions and discussions, and then everybody in the panel, I invite to ask everybody else questions if you have questions to the other. Why don't we start with Dr. Cheryl Soriano from De La Salle University.
Yeah. Thank you, Claire. Good morning, everyone. I prepared something, so I'll be reading some of parts of it. I'll try to sexify it as much as possible. Most likely, I will fail. So 10 years ago, when I was starting my PhD, there was much enthusiasm about the empowering potential of the internet, prophesying the advent of a cyber-democratic society, or the emancipation of citizens from state power or market forces. Pierre Lévy even anticipated the fall of dictatorships around the world, resulting from a participatory patriot culture and collective intelligence facilitated by online media. With all these hopes of the past, it is thus lamentable, as Tim Berners-Lee himself worriedly expressed last year, about how the same affordances and features that help under-resourced groups are also used by certain sectors with bad intentions to game the system for financial or political gain. What is the relationship between democracy and disinformation? To confront this relationship, I will use the three democratic participation axes proposed by some scholars, Vettel and Brindle, in their analysis of cyber democracy, but try to simplify it. The first element focuses on the value of information, number one, and the model of an informed citizen, which is central to liberal democratic thought. Information is an important prerequisite for all forms of political participation. How can you participate and formulate an opinion without information? The internet has been praised for providing access to vast amounts of information, but also in democratizing this creation of information. As Peter Dahlgren argued, the open and accessible character of the internet also means that traditional centers of power have less informational and ideational control than previously held. Misinformation, or the unintentional sharing of the false information, and disinformation, or the deliberate intentional creation and sharing of information known to be false, are therefore both threats to democracy. Disinformation is worse because this is not just about people's inability to ascertain evidence-based information from those intended to be false, but it also manifests the role of orchestrators of disinformation, those that intentionally seek to manipulate, mislead, deceive, or silence evidence-based information for specific purposes, such as the advancement of political agenda. Moving from information, the second axis is discussion and debate, also crucial for democratic participation, which relies on the model of an active citizen who shapes his or his political opinion by participating in an exchange of views with those of other citizens or representatives. Theories of democracy have treated the discussion among citizens as vital to the functioning of a public sphere. Early enthusiastic accounts consider the internet as an incarnation of a Habermasian public sphere based on rational critical discourse. This relates to one of the most saluted features of the internet, its interactive potential. Shirowiki even labeled this as facilitating sort of a wisdom of crowds. But as we all know, and as evidenced by growing research, our experiences of social media counter these assumptions as we see a deep fragmentation and cheapening of our communicative interactions and debates online. Hate speech and trolling undermine these exchanges, and so is disinformation in a broad sense, making it difficult to come up with meaningful, rational, critical exchange. The impassioned exchange of opposing views should not be seen as threatening itself, as argued by Mouffe. Yet the problem is when loud, passionate voices of those seeking to mislead and spread warp messages end up silencing others. The third axis, from information to discussion and debate, is moving on to mobilization, or coming together to act in concert. Participative citizens need to be informed and engaged in order to act collectively and mobilize for collective good. While some authors deplore a weakening of social ties in current societies, cyber enthusiasts argue that computer-mediated communication supports
the formation of social networks and new forms of community or associational life. And this has supported many under-resourced and dispersed activist networks, NGOs, people's organizations. The kinds of associational groups forged by the internet to advocate and advance social good needs to be celebrated very well. But it also gave rise to communities and associational groups and networks of disinformation without real ideological connection. Social and participatory media is key to manipulation because it enables those with fringe views to find each other, collaborate on media production and dissemination, and share viewpoints that would be inaccessible to air in traditional media, sometimes hiding under the veil of anonymity and thereby eliding responsibility. In short, the problem we have is that people have started to form ties and associational linkages and throw their support, as loose as they may be, with others, including those hired to advance political agenda to spread disinformation. So in bringing the three, I close, the problem of democracy in this day is, first, the intentional distortion of information or creation of false information and its active spread. Second, the participation and exchange by grassroots supporters and paid trolls and influencers around false claims that results in undermining the value of debate and discussion in this democratic society. And third, the mobilization by agents with strong political agenda of supporters, real supporters, to act in concert around intentionally falsified information.
Thank you very much. Next, we will hear maybe from a global view from Mr. Peter Gresty. And Peter Gresty has been also a victim of legislation against the publication of false information. He was imprisoned for 400 days in Egypt, and maybe we can hear about his experiences.
Thank you very much. I'm here, I think, although I'm carrying the title of Professor of Journalism and Communication at the University of Queensland, I am here, I think, more as a practitioner, as a journalist who spent 25 years on the road. My last job was with Al Jazeera, where I was in Egypt and arrested on terrorism charges and placed in prison. I think there are two things that I really wanted to say in my opening remarks. The first is that there are two ways in which democracy can backslide on these things. Obviously, there's the malign way, the sort of democratic backsliding that we seem to be seeing here in the Philippines, in the sort of thing that we saw in Egypt. But there is also a benign backsliding, which is a kind of thing that we're even seeing in my own country, in Australia, where governments, and let me go back, there is a common denominator in both these situations, where governments have been using national security as an opportunity, as an excuse to roll back on all sorts of democratic reforms, to close down freedom of speech, to silence the press, to introduce all sorts of laws that limit the work that the press can do. What happened to us in Egypt was a pretty egregious example of that kind of malign intent, where the government passed laws that were designed, it said, to deal with national security. It said that Egypt is, I think, at the moment the third biggest jailer of journalists behind Turkey and I think China. And Egypt says publicly that it doesn't imprison journalists for their journalism. It says that it doesn't have any journalists as such in prison. It says that it only has terrorists. Now that's exactly what happened to us. Where the government defined terrorism so loosely that to do your job meant that you were, in the government's eyes, promoting terrorist ideology. Now that was a pretty, as I said, everyone's seen what's been taking place in Egypt. We've seen a dictatorship establish itself and entrench itself. We've seen growing intolerance for dissent for any alternative political views. But even in Australia, in my own country, we've just had a very serious debate around new national security legislation, which to my eyes has a disturbingly similar echo to what was being introduced in Egypt, where the government has defined, the legislation is around espionage, and the government has defined a criminal act under the espionage laws so loosely that simply receiving a document from a civil servant, a classified document from a leak, from a source, can wind you up in prison. The law, if the law can be loosely interpreted, at some point it will be loosely interpreted. And the problem is that when it comes to the issues around national security, public safety, which are the kinds of things we keep hearing in the Philippines to justify all sorts of closing down of public space, that with that comes back a role, a retreat from democracy, a retreat from freedom of speech, a retreat from a free press. And I think that's something that is incredibly dangerous. We're seeing it more and more. And because it is politically acceptable for politicians to argue to be strong on national security, to be strong on public security, without serious critical thinking, it's very easy for the public to say, yes, of course, we must do that because we all need to be safe.
Thank you very much. We will follow up on some of your excellent points in the Q&A portion, but for now we'll hear from Dr. Encinas of the Political Science Department.
Hi, good morning to everyone. I'm delighted to be here, and I thank Professor Clarissa David for inviting me to this panel and to this very timely and relevant conference. What is fake news for me? I draw from the definition of Alcott and Jensko when they refer to fake news as news articles that are intentionally and verifiably false and could mislead readers. The operative terms, I think, here are intentionally and verifiably false. While this definition encompasses some of the things that we have read in the local news as well as from abroad, I think we need to also add a dimension of fake news proliferation as being systematically implemented, mainly to account for the study of Jonathan Ong and Jason Cabanyes, which I understand will be presented tomorrow, which tells us about how fake news is operated at different levels. How is fake news different from disinformation? Fake news produces disinformation that can harm individuals and societies in many ways, and indeed a threat to democracy in general, particularly because it undermines the positive role of media in democratic societies. It legitimizes government crackdown on the media in general and has a chilling effect on the opposition, who may be wary of being targets of fake news. It can also be used by authoritarian regimes to manufacture legitimacy, such as in the case of Prime Minister Hun Sen, who has been accused of the Cambodian opposition of buying Facebook likes. According to the news report about the petition, Hun Sen's page is liked by 9.4 million people, even though only 4.8 million people use FB in Cambodia. And despite the fact that the page is written in Khmer. Well, as a trivia, I also follow Justin Trudeau's Facebook account, even if I don't know French. Fake news can also prop up support for controversial government policies. We have seen this in the Marawi conflict, in which fake photos and what have you proliferated, mainly with the aim to generate the support to martial law in Mindanao. Fake news can lead to violence, as when a man in the run-up to the 2016 elections in the US fired at a pizza restaurant thinking that there are children held as sex slaves inside, with alleged links to Hillary Clinton. Fake news can also deny the legitimacy of political foes or enable politicians to dismiss accountability by branding as fake news any media report alleging corruption by the administration. Lastly, which for me is very important when we talk about democracy, is that fake news enables anyone with a misogynist agenda to use gendered language, manufactured fake images, videos, etc., to malign women, especially women politicians, and undermine women's role in politics, which we have staunchly fought for since 1937. This is abhorrent and discourages many women from entering the public sphere. It denigrates, quote-unquote, the feminine, to quote the feminist scholar V. Spike Peterson. Even Hillary Clinton, during the 2016 elections in the US, fell victim to this. In the Philippines, we can see this currently being done by both those who support and resist the current administration. For those who are lucky, their fake news can even merit a congressional investigation to be feasted on by mostly male legislators. Women and the LGBT community are the prime targets of fake news, as this bodes well for its clickbait nature. Why do misogynist fake news sell? Because they strike at what is familiar, the gendered hierarchies to which most of us are socialized. That the poster girl of fake news in the Philippines is a woman, I believe, is not an accident, but by design. Misogynist fake news is pernicious because we may identify that it is fake news, but we laugh at them and even share them at times, which tells us that misogynist fake news may even sell better compared to other types of fake news. The end game for all this is what I would call the boy who cried wolf syndrome. Nobody will believe the media when it is already telling the truth. Who then can we turn to? Who will guard the guardians, especially in these times when our political institutions are being attacked in all fronts? The media, as the fourth estate, must be the beacon of hope during this time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Dr. Franco, I have a question for Cheryl. Do you think that there's something different about this information? You talked about the difference between what's intentional and unintentional. Do you think that there's something specific about intentional disinformation campaigns when it's state orchestrated or when the source is a state? Because we often hear that this has been around, propaganda has been around forever. Why is it something that we should be concerned about today as a special problem?
I think intentional and orchestrated disinformation is particularly in the context of social media, which has a high possibility for programmability and manipulation, right? So if your strategy is intentional, deliberately planned, well orchestrated, you really can study the system. Well, as mentioned by Ron earlier, you can study the audience, you can study the messaging that will work in relation to your audience, and then use the system's affordances to make sure that your message is well amplified and reaches your audience at the very moment that you need it to spread. So that I think is dangerous. It can be used by activists as well, by journalists as well, but the fact that it can be used by people of particular kinds of intentions is what's worrying.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, I think there's also another point where, and I want to be very careful to underline the fact that I'm not anti-social media, but one of the things is if we go back to the days of pre-social media, if the government lied, the journalists acted as gatekeepers, and we had a responsibility, a professional and ethical responsibility, but also a commercial incentive to check and cross-check and call out those lies. It was very difficult for the government to communicate directly with the people without going through the media, without going through the journalists. They could still hold news conferences and issue press releases, but journalists doing their professional jobs would fact check and call out anything that they felt was wrong. That doesn't mean that we weren't victims of misinformation, as Cheryl was saying earlier when he spoke about the Gulf War and the lies that President George W. Bush told. But the fact is that that system has, to a greater or lesser degree, kept politicians reasonably honest as well as ourselves. But social media has allowed us open up pipelines directly from politicians to those people who support them. And the problem is that we all like to see and hear and read news that agrees with our opinions. If we see and hear a politician saying something that we like or we agree, if it feels truthy, then we tend to like it and we tend to support it and continue to promote it. Anything that contradicts that view, even if that view is wrong, all of a sudden becomes fake news in our own eyes. And that's why I think we're seeing things really turbocharged in the current environment in ways that we've never seen before. Now, that doesn't mean I think we should roll everything back to the good old days when there was no social media. Clearly, social media has a lot to give us. But we need to recognize the problems, and I think we need to be a lot more aggressive in the way that we design the structure of the system, the checks and balances, to make sure that we do have the capacity to hold politicians to account, to keep them honest, and that we do have the capacity as journalists to produce stories that genuinely challenge those in power.
And just maybe as a brief background, or if some of the audience are not familiar, there have been, I think, 2 or 3 Senate hearings to try to come up with or propose legislation to address the problem of fake news and disinformation. And there have been many attempts to try to discuss whether legislation is the solution. And I think, Peter, you also are in a unique position to discuss this, is what are the dangers of legislating against, because there seems to be this moral panic that we are all in, where we say this is something that needs to get fixed, it's so broken, and it seems like the initial reaction has been to try to design legislation. What are the dangers of that solution?
Yeah, I think there is a huge danger that where you try and impose legislative solutions on this. Again, let me go back to what happened to us in Egypt, where the government introduced some legislation that on the face of it was designed to protect national security. It was designed to stop promoting terrorist ideology. It was designed to stop the spread of false news to undermine national security. Now, the problem was, and as I said, on the face of it, it's very difficult to argue against any kind of law that would protect the country from terrorist ideology. Well, the problem was that the government then defined terrorism so loosely as to include what most people would consider to be the political opposition. And so as a journalist, when we went out and interviewed the opposition, the Muslim Brotherhood at the time, we put that to air. As far as the government was concerned, we were, by definition, therefore, promoting terrorist ideology. The government branded the opposition as terrorists. We were accused of broadcasting false news to undermine national security. Again, on the face of it, a piece of legislation like that is hard to argue against. But that's how it was interpreted. And when you introduce laws to try and deal with that sort of situation, as I mentioned earlier, the Australian government has been doing something similar. After very fierce public debate, I might want to add, the government has been forced to roll back on some of that, on the more draconian elements of that legislation, of that bill. But I think the trend is there, and this is the problem, that when you criminalise these kinds of transgressions, you give a lot of power to the authorities to use that as a tool to silence free press, and it becomes anything that challenges the integrity of the state, anything that undermines confidence in the state institutions can be interpreted as the political opposition. So I have real problems with legislative solutions. I think there are things that the government can do to create the kind of architecture around social media to encourage legitimate reporting, to discourage fake news. These are solutions for people, for lawyers and the like, with a much higher pay grade than I. But I would caution against being in a rush to introduce laws, particularly draconian laws, to try and stop fake news. Because again, remember, fake news, as far as the government is often concerned, as far as politicians are concerned, and we keep hearing it time and again, we saw President Duterte using the term, fake news becomes anything which contradicts me, anything that undermines me. That by definition is fake news in the eyes of government, and that means that every person in this room who's doing their jobs as a journalist becomes guilty of that.
Thank you. Jean, what do you think, how do you deal with this when the population seems to be so supportive? It seems supportive of many types of solutions that are criminalizing behaviors, that are trying to stamp out the job that the press is doing and trying to limit free speech. We see a lot of the discourse really talking about how we should restrict some of these freedoms in the context of trying to change the constitution of the country. What do you think about the public support aspect of it?
The public support aspect is there, of course, but I think for senators or for legislators, they're more interested in curtailing press freedom because they're really not interested in campaign finance reform. Because that, to me, is, I think, one of the solutions, especially that the 2019 elections is coming. I think a lot of politicians, and we're seeing that already nowadays, are going to use social media to their utmost advantage because it's cheap, and it's getting a lot more people in such a short time.
Do you think, maybe Cheryl, you can comment on this, how should journalists now deal with their position in the market? Because it seems like a lot of the attacks online and the attacks also on television and in the statements of the president and other officials of the government has been to try to undermine the credibility of journalism, the practice itself. How can journalists try to gain the trust of the public again?
Well, my initial idea is you really just have to fight bad false news by good journalism. Journalists should show what they can do and what they can do differently, right? That they can actually come up with evidence-based articulation of information, as had been shown in the video earlier, right? And I think that's the only way to go. Perhaps nuggets there about how to amplify that information so that they can reach the public, and perhaps they can work with a lot of different organizations as well. This is a special event where CSOs, academics, journalists have come together in mounting. So I think If we are serious about this, journalists can co-develop different kinds of strategies with other kinds of sectors to help in supporting evidence-based articulation of ideas.
Jean?
I think self-regulation is really the way to go. There's also one thing that bothers me, and I don't know if it can be classified as fake news or whatever, but there's this, I mean, even before social media, there's already this practice of weaving advertising within radio or TV programs. I don't know how you call it, but most people are not just interested in listening to the news, but not interested in knowing where to get a liver capsule or a juice, not even vetted or approved by the FDA. So I think, I don't know, but that's something that should also be reviewed.
Okay. I'm just going to weigh in here because I think one of the problems is we in this debate, we tend to lose sight of some really important fundamentals. Let's go back to basics. Remember, the media is the fourth estate. It's supposed to sit alongside the judiciary, the legislature, and the executive. We're the fourth pillar. We're supposed to keep the bastards honest. We easily forget the politicians work for us in a democracy. That's how it's supposed to work. We hire them when we vote for them. We pay their salaries through our taxes. We are their employers. So as their employers, we have a responsibility to know what is being done in our names in a democracy. We tend to forget that. And as journalists, as the media, as academics, we've lost sight of that argument. We need to make that case. And we need to make that case as a unified industry. What happened to us in Egypt was a rather extraordinary thing, because I know from my own personal experience that journalists are a really fractious bunch. The only time we tend to ever move in the same direction is when there's a bar in the room. Otherwise, we tend to fight each other. I mean, that's who we are. By nature, we're cantankerous, noisy, rowdy lot. We tend not to agree with each other. But what happened to us in Egypt was an extraordinary example of what you can do when the industry pulls together as one. I know in this country there were thousands of journalists, people who were tweeting Free AJ staff, and journalism is not a crime. The Free AJ staff hashtag received something like 3 billion impressions during the time that we were in prison. It wasn't just here, it was all over the world. CNN, BBC, and not just Al Jazeera, all of our colleagues in Australia, there was an extraordinary unity of purpose. And what that unity of purpose did was that it sprung 3 innocent guys from prison. And I don't know anywhere else where that's actually happened. Now, what we need to do is refine that sense of purpose, remind the public what it is that we have a responsibility to do and do that job well, and remind them that we need to keep politicians to account. We need a free, strong, independent press, because fundamentally you cannot have a strong democracy unless you have strong journalism.
So how can we, because I think for this country the scale at which the attacks have been coming is very quick, and I think maybe there are lessons from around the world that we can draw from. Do you have any insights from what you've seen in other countries in terms of tactics? Is this something that's unique to the Philippines, where you have state institutions trying to actively undermine the media's credibility in the eyes of the public?
Well, no. I mean, what we saw in Egypt was another example of that. To a greater or lesser extent, we see it take place in places like Turkey and Russia and elsewhere. This is not an easy thing, don't get me wrong. I'm not suggesting that there is a simple switch, a solution, an easy option. But I do think that there needs to be a kind of coming together of minds and a recognition that we all, as the media, as a journalist, and frankly, as a democracy, we've got an interest in holding together as a block, as a unified media industry, as a group of journalists, all pushing in the same direction. That's very difficult when we're all desperately scrabbling around to survive, when we're all trying to win clicks and eyeballs and advertising revenue. But we've also got to recognize that, frankly, our own survival depends on coming together, of finding that common sense of purpose, whether you unite around a single hashtag, whether there's other conferences like this, because this is a really important and valuable start to this, that we need to constantly remind people and give people the same message. We're not very good at that as journalists because we always like to find the story and move on. As Ron was saying in the last panel, a lie told over and over again is much more powerful than a single news story. And as an industry, what we like to do is give a news story. You're constantly told that you're not to open your mouth, you're not to put pen to paper unless you have something new to add. We have to take a leaf out of the public relations industry and keep banging on that message time and again. Again, it's got to be consistent. It's got to be unified. It's got to be across the industry. If that happens, then I think we might start reminding people why it's important and start pushing back.
Thank you. Jean, what are your thoughts on this, the very basic idea of the media as the fourth estate? Is that something that from the political scientists in the country, is that something that is that has been present in our politics, and has it been rooted enough so that it's not so easy to displace that idea?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, in the history, for instance, of Philippine politics, media has given us or has provided us a very integral role. And I don't think we can afford not to have a free media. It certainly helped advance our democracy, and any attempts to curtail press freedom should be combated. And I think this conference is a good start, and may this just be a beginning of a concerted effort to fight for press freedom.
I totally agree with Peter and Jean on this. Just a point of reflection also, though, that some people have found an avenue for expression on the internet freely, because they may have felt that traditional media is exclusive to certain people, intelligent people who can pass through editorials, editorialized writing, for example. So I guess one way is to show how journalism can be inclusive of, speaking of people's common issues as well, and at the same time challenging perhaps articulations of some people that media is biased, that the media represents only particular sides or views, because the other side is using that as a reason for, the internet is democratizing, actually. It's allowing ordinary people to speak when they haven't been able or given the chance to speak before. So I think it's crucial to challenge those assumptions as well, and by simply showing that the media has a very important role as the fourth estate of the country.
I'd just like to invite people who have questions to please hand over your questions to the lovely, our lovely assistants in the room who are in the side. But maybe before we get our questions, what do you think, now that we've had this, social media has allowed for these direct relationships between the public and the politicians? And this has been here for quite some time. It's almost organic right now that all politicians will have a Twitter account, all politicians will have a Facebook account, they will answer specific questions from their constituencies. How does the press sort of go back to its role and say, we have a role to mediate this relationship, there is a function for the press? Now that you have a population, and a generation really, that's used to it.
I wish I had an answer to that, an easy answer. I don't think it's right, and I think what you were saying a moment ago is really true, that there is that the internet, that social media has given, has created a democracy of voices, and we did have this arrogant period when we as journalists kind of stood on our pulpits and handed down these sermons of information, and the public simply had to receive it, and there was very little feedback, and we do need to learn a degree of humility about that and learn to become a lot more responsive to news or to various voices that were otherwise shut out of mainstream media. I mean, there is a reason why social media has taken off, because it does have power. It does allow direct conversations that were never allowed before. But we also need to take heart from the recent uptick in subscriptions for news organizations like the New York Times and the Washington Post, particularly in the Trump era, as people are starting to look for anchors of information and analysis that they can trust, of sensible, solid, fact-based information. Because let's face it, facts are stubborn things. Whatever people talk about the sort of durability of lies, facts are fundamentally much more, they're stubborn things that you stub your toe on time and again. And I think it's, again, without wanting to sound too woolly about it, the fact is that if we can start to regain some of that professional integrity, start to step back a little bit from the desperate struggle for clicks, then and hold that line on professionalism, on analysis, on accuracy and integrity, then I think we might start to reclaim some of that ground. But I want to go back to what I was saying earlier. We're not going to do it unless we remind our audiences of why it is really important that they pay attention to that kind of work, and they make the distinction between fake and or cheap news or unreliable sources and those that they can really trust.
Go ahead.
Yeah. What's interesting, you were asking the question of what does it do for us that politicians and people get connected via social media? I would say that this is precisely what we wanted when we were advancing e-governance and e-participation, right? Like, even at 2006, we wanted politicians, officials of government to have direct access to these politicians and local government officials. And we wanted different kinds of ways to make the budget more transparent. I think it's really a question of intention. And of course, the tendency of the systems to get abused. So it's really tricky because we wanted this, not exactly what we have, but we aspired to have more connection between local government officials and the people.
Okay, let me turn to it just took the audience a while to get the questions in because they're essay type. No, they're fantastic questions. I want to make sure we try to cover as many of them as possible. Here's the first one. Would it be correct to say that polarization of society into political factions, in the case of the Philippines, Dutertards and Yellowtards and leftists, with all of the name-calling that's attached to that, that polarization of society into political factions has caused or is one of the causes of misinformation and disinformation, and does this misinformation and disinformation also amplify the existing polarization of the country? Jean, do you want to take a stab at that?
I think to engage or to even believe in that binary DDS or yellow tards, it's a disservice to us Filipinos. We're just Filipinos. We're neither DDS or yellow tards. Because if we engage in that binarism, then we're buying. It discourages us from saying the things we want just because we're afraid that we will be labeled as yellow tard. So I think we should not entertain those thoughts. We have to admit it has escalated into polarization, if some people would call it as such. But in a sense, if polarization is there, then it means that there's a venue for us to actually talk about these things and express our views on what's happening. I mean, it's very difficult if we can no longer express our views on what's happening.
Here's another question. Do you think that the willingness of the public to join the attack on the Fourth Estate indicates an impatience with democracy? We can't wait anymore. We need this fixed.
That's a really, that's a good question. I'm the fact that I'm not a Filipino. I don't have no experience of the Philippines, so it's very difficult for me to draw any conclusions or say anything meaningful about the Philippine experience here. But there's no doubt, and again, we're going to sound a little bit like a broken record because the fundamental messages are always going to be the same. The discontent with the media is real, and we've got to take responsibility for that and recognize what it means for us as journalists and academics. That doesn't mean that we should simply throw up our hands and say, well, you know, there's nothing for us to be done. We just have to live with it and accept that we're all due to die. What we need to do is also recognize that we're in a period of transition at the moment. I don't think anybody really knows. I mean, 10 years ago, no one could have foretold the kind of world that we would find ourselves discussing today. And I think only a fool is going to pretend to know what it's going to look like in 5 years, much less 10 years' time. So we are in a period of transition, and that's one of the reasons why I think there's so much confusion and chaos and frustration with the way things are going. But we also need to recognize why people are frustrated, because they do feel shut out of the conversations, because they feel as though they're not hearing good information, because the media isn't able to deliver the kinds of analysis that they feel that they ought to be getting from us, all sorts of reasons. But what we need to start doing, I think, is to almost invert the question, rather than say, what's wrong with the system? We ought to be saying, okay, what is it that we want from the system, and how do we design the system to get us to that point? What do we require from the media in a functioning democracy? What do people want as consumers? And how do we create a system that will get us to that point? We're trying to patch things up at the moment. We're trying to kind of running around almost like we've got this leaky boat, and we're desperately trying to stick bits of plastic over all of the holes, and we've lost sight of the fact that the boat just isn't working, it's sinking, and we need to completely rethink how we build it. And that's a conversation that I don't think has been happening in any country that I'm aware of.
Okay, there's a great question here. Is the idea of the fourth estate an analog concept in a digital world? What should be the nature and role of citizen journalism in this new information environment? I'm going to throw that to Cheryl first, because I want to give you a hard time. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah, I think citizen journalism is really important. Community journalism specifically too. I think we have to be really thinking about how good journalism can reach the people the most vulnerable. And this is where I guess citizen journalism in partnership with, you know, your other established media institutions can work together in making people feel that local issues, community issues are really represented. That's all I guess I'll have to say. I mean, Peter.
I'm sorry, I'm hugging the floor.
Yeah. I think citizen journalism or community journalism is very important, given that dailies, even the traditional media, usually cover national news. And we actually don't know what's going on at the local level. Even during elections, we know who to vote for at the national level, but we hardly know our local councilors. Nobody votes during the barangay elections. So I think it's very, very important in terms of holding local politicians accountable.
I'm going to have a crack here. And I'm going to respectfully disagree, because I think there's a danger of confusing citizen journalism with local journalism. There is a real need for local journalism, and I'm not discounting the role that citizen journalism has to play, but let's be honest here. When we talk about citizen journalism, we mean amateur journalism. We mean journalism that is not produced by professionals. Now, I don't know, hands up here who would go to a citizen brain surgeon. Yeah, exactly. We go to professionals because professionals know and understand the subtleties of the job that they're doing. I'm not suggesting that there is not a role for ordinary people to write stories and contribute information. That's important and valuable, and as journalists, we have a responsibility to hear and deal with that information. But we need to celebrate and underline the need for professionals who understand the issues, who know how to check information, who know how to create a story with integrity, who know how to work independently, who know how to avoid, how to set aside their own prejudices to get to stories. That's what professional journalists do. not citizen journalists. Citizen journalists have access to Grind and so on. I'm not suggesting by definition that they're compromised or that they're biased, just that citizen journalists are not professional journalists. And we need to make sure what it is that we're talking about. Local journalism is really important. Everybody is interested, much more interested in what's happening in the local council. They're much more concerned about the potholes in the street being fixed than they are about foreign policy. All of the surveys keep telling us that. And that's really important. We need to find ways of financing really good local journalism. But that's a structural problem. It's not a way, I think, for not a justification for handing over the baton to amateurs.
Thank you. Related to that, and this is a room full of journalists and bloggers, and that's an attached sort of identity. Is citizen journalism the same as blogging? And when they're operating in the same media environment, where audiences start not being able to tell the difference between the products of professional journalists, bloggers, and citizen journalists, what happens? How does professional journalism protect its space and identity in that kind of audience market? And I think that's sort of an issue everywhere, that the information environment has all of this content, and now you can't tell who you're going to believe, and you're led by who you agree with as being the final arbiter of what you think is truth.
It's a real problem, and we operate in a space where certification and authorization authority is a very difficult one. There, and again, I'm not pretending to have a solution to everything, but there is, you know, we have a system of accreditation of accredited journalists. Twitter has its blue tick. People fight very hard to get that blue tick because a blue tick actually means something. I'm not necessarily suggesting that only professional journalists ought to get blue ticks, but there is something in that system of verification. Whether we formalize it or not, I think this is something that we need to be discussing, need to be debating. How do we single out, how do we identify credible sources of news? How do we accredit those journalists who have a reputation to uphold? How do we, not necessarily license, but at least acknowledge journalists that's produced with professionalism and integrity and make the distinction between those and unreliable sources? We need to have those discussions. We shouldn't be shy about having those discussions. I think we need to try very hard to help audiences, because there was a study in the United States recently that found that 75% of Americans were fooled by fake headlines. 75%. Now, even journalists are humans. I know I had to do a double take. I checked when I saw headlines saying that the Pope had endorsed Donald Trump for president. I thought, hang on a tick, wow. That's quite something. The Pope's really going out on a limb here. But hands up those who haven't looked at something and thought for a second, wow, that's a really interesting story, and only to recognize after some time that actually it was fake. Well, if we struggle, if we're taken in from time to time, then of course others are going to, ordinary members of the public who aren't schooled and who aren't working in the industry as we are going to be fooled. We need to help them. We need to give our readers a way, the tools to make those distinctions as well. As I said, I'm not pretending to have easy solutions here, but I think that we need to have some focused discussions, put some real effort, some real research into finding ways of verifying credible sources.
In relation to another question in relation to that, and specific to the local scene, is that where we have legitimate media organizations or news organizations in the Philippines that have established trust in the country over the years until very recently and is now being attacked specifically as being the main purveyors of disinformation. And then other people or other sources of information are calling themselves the real media. How do we deal with, what are the dangers of that? Where this is a specific example of how non-journalists or non-media entities are working to really undermine the credibility of the press in the Philippines. How can we bring back the value that the general public places on the products that our press churn out on a daily basis?
Well, not directly addressing it, but perhaps also the danger of media manipulation in social media. There's the tendency, the vulnerability of in the internet, it's an attention economy, right? Everyone wants to get attention in social media, and the goal is to, when one sees something that's attention worthy, one wants to present it as fast as possible. And in the context of this, those manipulators of this information may get some media organizations, journalists even bait them into actually reporting or highlighting this. And I guess that's where some sectors question some sectors of the media for becoming victims of disinformation as well. So I think challenging that and being cautious about architects of disinformation that may actually be targeting, specifically trying to manipulate professional media organizations, I think our media institutions are getting more and more aware of that, including specific targeting them and discrediting them. But it's really a disinformation ecosystem, perhaps, that's, and studies have been published on this in the US about media manipulation, really strategic media manipulation, and how journalists, professional journalists, should be worried and be cautious about.
Jean? In relation to your point earlier about the 2019 elections and the barangay elections, now that we're a couple of years or a year away from local elections, how do we help audiences distinguish between the regular propaganda that happens in any local election that happened before, with more current efforts of disinformation that are less benign, and not that any of those are benign, but more easily spread?
Yeah, that's a difficult question to answer, but I think there have been solutions already proposed by some enhanced media literacy trainings, and overall, I think there's also a call for humanities and the liberal arts to be enhanced in schools and even in high school. So that's a long-term solution. And that was why I was pointing out earlier that what happens to genuine media organizations when they're already telling the truth, people will be skeptical even if they see the real news. So I think it's always it should be a practice for all of us to because of the nature of the internet, you're a very distracted consumer. So you're very prone to clickbait articles, and so that's what's going for fake news purveyors. So I think it's best to always triangulate the information that we have, verify with other sources. We know we don't have the time, but the least that we can do is not to spread it, not to share it right away.
In relation to that, there's a question here that asks about the 2019 polls. Do you think there should be rules from the Commission on Elections as regards disinformation and political campaigning?
Yeah, I think it's about time that we have a campaign finance reform. To be fair, it has been lobbied by a lot of civil society organizations a long, long time ago, even before the fake news issue came about. But nothing came out of it, mainly because it's very difficult to legislate these things, especially when politicians are the subjects and the objects of change.
From the perspective of a practicing journalist, in an environment where journalism is under threat, like specific threats from state agents, which is happening here in the Philippines with much more veracity lately, can journalists really still be expected to be neutral, or is there an expectation of neutrality? Is that still the best way to go about this?
Yeah, I think neutrality is a really important thing to hold on to, a really important ideal. And neutrality doesn't mean objective. We sometimes, I think, get trapped into this idea of objectivity, and we try and often sell the work that we do as objective, and that's only ever going to get us into trouble, because every single person in this room is going to walk away with a different perspective about what was said in this panel. Not that anyone is lying, it's just or is disseminating fake truth, fake news. It's just that each person will pick up different pieces of information. Different things will be important. They'll have different priorities. And so I think we need to step away from the idea of objectivity. We need to stop pretending that we are somehow, as journalists, we are somehow dealing with facts like handing these things down on tablets of stone, and make people understand that we are independent, but that we hold to certain values. That's accuracy, balance, fairness. Those are the things, and independence. Those are the things that we need to be championing. And once people understand that, once they sort of recognize that every story has a particular, not necessarily a particular line, but that they are challenging or running a story in a way from a particular viewpoint, then we can start having a reasonable conversation about the work that we're doing. But if we try and pretend that we are somehow objective, then I think we're going to find ourselves in trouble.
In relation to the, we're not, I'm sorry, I'm just going to have to apologize to the audience because I have many questions here. Clearly, we're going to run out of time, but I will try to get through a couple more. Specific to the current environment in the Philippines, there's a long question here in specific to the Inquirer. The superstructure that supports disinformation or fake news, the internet and social media, is also eating into the fuel that fires up traditional media, ad revenue and circulation specifically. That has always been the vulnerability of Philippine media, arguably all media that's commercial in nature. That vulnerability is even more pronounced now, with even one of our top news outfits, Inquirer, feeling the pinch in ad revenue as its readers turn online for free content. In the Inquirer's case, that vulnerability has led to an ally of Duterte, allegedly, that's me editorializing, allegedly, trying, buying a majority stake in the paper. What are your thoughts on that? Where you have this vulnerability that's not really just on the audience side, but vulnerability of media from the commercial side of things, and how political movements can exacerbate that.
There have been questions and suggestions for media organizations to think about alternative revenue generation mechanisms. Ads are crucial, and specifically sponsored ads, pushing them on Facebook. It's crucial, but again, you become prone to the attention economy, right? So alternative revenue generation mechanisms are being recommended I think some organizations are trying to do this now, right? Getting the support of organic support of people who really believe in the value of evidence-based journalism. Yeah, maybe the others may have other thoughts.
Of course, we cannot deny, I think all of us are one in saying that media entities are first and foremost business enterprises, and I think it's a sad part of our history that it's every time there's an autocrat, the media is always a target. And I think that's one way to curtail or to stifle dissent. And I guess what we can do is to just, do things like this, forum, and to always be vigilant in any efforts by this regime or other future administrations to curtail press freedom. Because remember, Erap Estrada also attempted to do that to the Inquirer before. So let's see what happens.
I'll have a last question that I'll pose to everybody as a closing, because I think we have 10 minutes left. It's related to, there's a couple of questions here interrelated, related to the idea of inclusivity of the media and representing different voices. With the emergence of populism and the disinformation that comes with it, is it timely to ask the state of our media and democracy, has it been more inclusive? Is there a way to make it more inclusive, and has it delivered on that, representing the concerns of the common people or the common man? So Cheryl, I will throw that to you since you're the one that first mentioned it.
The problem with that is that it's really very difficult to measure. Is the current media inclusive? And what kind of participation do we really want? Is it an? And sometimes what's measurable is a more surface level kind of participation. How many likes, how many clicks? But is that really the kind of participation that we want? Especially in a complex information economy where likes, clicks can be manufactured. So I think we should be more concerned about the quality of participation that we're getting, and the quality of discussions around issues where journalists could take a crucial role in leading, again, because information and evidence-based information is crucial first and foremost before we can discuss issues, and then invite people as openly as possible to come in and give in their take on these issues.
I'm speaking as a media consumer and not actually as a practitioner. I think inclusiveness is still a work in progress. I see inclusiveness in terms of people that media outlets quote every time they report an issue. I think it's very, very important. For instance, in the West Philippine Sea issue, we often hear or, you know, watch TV news report about foreign policy. They quote or they cite, they interview foreign policy makers, but they rarely interview people who will be affected by this on the ground, such as, for instance, fisher folks and their families.
Peter, last word. What do you think about participation and inclusiveness in journalism?
I'm going to pass on the fundamentals of the question, which dealt specifically with the Philippines, because that's clearly something I don't really know about, I'm afraid.
But in general, what is it you think journalists have to adjust to in this? The idea that we expect so much participation from audiences, the engagement.
We have to be engaged. We have to be prepared to engage. You know, we can't roll the clock back to a time, you know, the sort of idealized past that we all might pine for, but, you know, never probably really existed. We've also got to recognize that technology has opened up so many opportunities for audiences, not just audience engagement in the sense that we stick a comments box at the bottom of every story, but that we encourage some kind of feedback loops. And this comes back to what I was saying earlier, where we really need to rethink the fundamental way that we design news organizations. One of the things that news organizations used to do was, the product for news organizations was the readers. The way it worked was, if you think about it, the way it worked was that news organizations would sell readers to their advertisers. The readers were the product. That model is broken down now, and in a way probably for the better, because it forces us to actually be much more responsive to readers, to be more focused on what readers want and engaged with readers. But we need to rethink the design that creates a revenue model that supports that. Now again, I'm not a guy that has a lot of experience or knowledge or understanding of that, so I'm not going to try and pretend to have any solutions. But it comes back to what I was saying earlier, where we have to think about what it was that we want, the role that we want our media to play in a functioning democracy. Once we answer that question, then we can say, okay, given the technologies that we have, how do we create that, how do we get to that point? then I think we might begin to start answering some of these really difficult questions.
Okay, thank you very much on behalf of the panel. Thank you to our wonderful audience and your great questions. I'm sorry I didn't get to everything. I will leave this for the next panel. Maybe they would like to answer some of them. Please feel free to approach our guests in the sidelines. And I think we should be ready for lunch at some point. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you to our panelists and our moderator. We'd like to remind our audience a couple of things. One, please bring your meal stubs with you. There are four.
Right, you just saw the conclusion of at least this part of this whole forum on democracy and disinformation. This particular segment focused on just that, disinformation and democracy, with UP Diliman's Gene Franco and Peter Greste, who's been a journalist for a bunch of other outfits, but the most recent of one is Al Jazeera. You also have DLSU's Cheryl Ruth Soriano and Clarissa David, of course, of UP Diliman. A very interesting and vibrant discussion there about democracy and disinformation. We're going to give you more on that in our succeeding newscasts. In the meantime, stay with ANC. Dateline Philippines is coming your way next. The employers of the Filipino worker whose body was found in a freezer in Kuwait. The Philippines, meanwhile, imposes a total deployment ban of Filipino workers to Kuwait. Journalists and members of the academe tackle fake news in a forum on disinformation and democracy in Makati. And no survivors in the plane crash in Russia. President Vladimir Putin has ordered an immediate investigation. Good afternoon, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Kuwaiti